Okay, so in the past, I have been extremely vocal about the fact that I am pro-life, and I'm also very public about being a Christian. But looking back at the way that I used to address pro-life and the way that I used to address abortion in general, I hate it. I think that I lacked a lot of compassion, and now that I've been like, that was stupid and wrong, I've deleted those, but I do want to come back and explain and make a video as to why I'm pro-life and why it is that you see a lot of Christians being predominantly pro-life. Like, I can definitely say that the majority of the church believes that abortion is wrong. So let's begin. I feel the need to emphasize the actual premise and the question that is being asked when there's a debate between being pro-life and pro-choice. Because a lot of people have misconstrued it to believe that the question asked is when does human life begin, when that's not true. There is scientific fact and there is objective truth behind when human life starts. This is not subjective and it is not philosophical. Science has proven that human life begins at conception. So the actual question being asked in regards to pro-choice and pro-life is when does it become immoral to legalize the removal or termination of innocent human life? So if people on both sides know what they're talking about, we both understand that it is not when does human life begin, it is when does it become immoral to remove this human life. And so the reason why we see most Christians being on the pro-life side of the argument is because of the worldview that Christians hold. And the only reason I bring this up is because a lot of people assume why Christians are pro-life and their assumptions tend to be wrong. And I can say that it's the other way around too. And so I think it's really important to understand why someone holds the view that they have because it results in a more civil conversation. So the Christian worldview is that human life has innate value because they were created by God and created in the image of God. We believe that all human beings have purpose because they were created by a purposeful God. Whenever I'm in a debate with a pro-choicer, they always ask me, give me a non-religious point of view as to why abortion is wrong. And honestly, I can admit that that's difficult because I can sit here and say, well, it's wrong because it's scientifically proven that this is human life. And the pro-choicer can respond with, well, why is it wrong? Because when I look at the world and when I look at culture, I look at it through the lens of Christianity. And the Christian worldview predisposes that being a human being is enough to be considered a person deserving of rights. And before anyone brings this up, I understand that Christians contradict this worldview. Yes, we're hypocrites, so is everybody else. But understand that we're just talking about pro-choice and pro-life right now. So the reason that I am pro-life is because I believe that the minute you become a human being, you also become a valuable person worthy of the right to live.
Okay, so I cannot just keep my mouth shut anymore. So back in May of 2020, I told my friends, I listed out a whole bunch of predictions of what is going to happen and what is going to come. I said, this is going to happen. And the hokey pokey was one of them. I told them this and they was like, I don't think that's going to happen. I said, okay. I said, all right. In due time, what happened is all over mainstream media news right now. Hokey pokey here. You can get a hokey pokey from Walgreens. You get a hokey pokey from Rite Aid, anywhere. And they came back to me. They was like, how did you know that this was going to happen? First of all, Bible prophecy. Second of all, it just made sense of what these high elite, cleverly evil, incredibly cleverly evil people are going to do. It just all made sense. And what people don't see, I see. I see a lot of crying in the future. There's going to be a lot of denial and delusion in the future. There's going to be, can't say that. But just know, I don't see it. It's not gonna be looking bright. And people in America, they don't see. They do not see. Majority of them don't. Some people do, but majority of them don't. A high percentage of people, they just don't see it. You think that it's gonna go back to normal and how it used to be back in 2019, in the very beginning of 2020. You want to shame me and think that I'm your enemy whenever I'm the one that's trying to help you. You know how, like, whenever you're watching a suspenseful movie and there is that one character or those couple of characters who are trying to warn the people who don't see in the movie? I'm that character in the movie, but this is real life. And what you don't see, I see. further that we go, the worse it will get. They're already talking about a cyber attack, a food shortage, inflation, hyperinflation. They're already talking about all these things right in front of your face and you don't see. Like, how do you not see what's going on here? Here's what you do. Get your cat food ready, get your water, get your canned goods, get your dog food ready, get everything ready, because once it goes down, it's going down. And Jesus already predicted these things that happen in Luke chapter 21, Matthew chapter 24, Revelation. Man, we're at the crack of the seals that are about to be broken open by Jesus. You can call me crazy, conspiracy, whatever you want, but whenever it happens, it is happening.
Hey everyone, I wanted to hop on here and tell you about this project that I'm getting ready to do. You know, the closer that I get to Jesus, the more he talks to me. And I was cutting grass yesterday and I kept hearing him say, "Josh, build me crosses. Josh, build me crosses." And I said, "All right, Lord, I'm gonna do that for you." So I started riding around to find a spot where I could do this at. And sure enough, I found the perfect place. So I was gonna show you exactly where it's gonna be at. Now, this is the road that it's gonna be in front of. It's Great Neck Landing Road in Hubert, if y'all wanna ever stop by or come by and see it when it's finished. But my land actually goes right up into a hill, right about there. So once we're finished, it'll probably be right on the left side of that shoulder right there. So we're actually going to build this the exact same size as the cross that Jesus was crucified on. There's going to be three crosses. Now I will ask, if this touches your heart or inspires you in any way, please share this to as many people as you can, and hopefully it'll inspire them to put crosses on their land. Now, it's gonna be big, so it ain't gonna be hard for people to see it. Now, once it came into my heart, I called my dad. He's gonna come help me, my neighbor Kelly. My mom's coming, my sister and my kids, so we can all be involved in it. So, if you stay tuned, I'm gonna record the whole process of us building it and setting it up. But y'all stay tuned. I appreciate y'all.
Hey guys, it's Leah. So I wanted to share something that's been really heavy on my heart today. First off, I want to start by reading you a Bible verse. So this comes from Jeremiah 1, 5. It says, "Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. And before you were born, I consecrated you. I appointed you a prophet to the nations." God literally knew you before you were even created. He literally had you in mind when he died on the cross, before you were put in your mom's womb. Can we just take a second? Like, I feel like we so easily just like skim over that. We're like, yeah, whatever, you know? But like, God knew you before you were you. Can we just, like, that's just mind blowing to me. And not only did he know you, personally know you, but he had plans for you. Later in Jeremiah, it's Jeremiah 29:11. It says, "For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future." So, God knew you as it says right here, and God had plans for you. And you see, today, I feel like so many of us, we sit there and we pick apart everything that's wrong with us, whether that's our physical appearance, whether that's the things that we're not good at, whether it's our insecurities. We just sit there and we pick apart. We hate on ourselves. We just, our heart is burdened of everything about us that we don't like, that society says we shouldn't like. I mean, for crying out loud, we look in the mirror and we're saddened. We're like, oh, I'm not as pretty as that person. Oh, I'm not, you know, I'm not skinny enough. I don't look this certain way. But, oh my goodness, God literally, like, who cares? Who cares? God knew you before you were you. Do you think the God that knew you before you were even created said, I'm gonna make her, you know, not how I want to. I'm gonna make her not as pretty as this other girl. No, you are literally God's masterpiece. Like, everything about you is created with intent and purpose. So why are we sitting there looking in the mirror, pointing out everything we don't like about ourselves, when God literally says he knew us in the womb, we were created, fearfully and wonderfully made? Why do we sit there and pick apart what's wrong?
You take a trip to Christ on special occasions, and most days you spend time on worldly stages, and you forget the creator. No, can't reach a Jesus holding hands with Satan, cause what he does makes you guilty by your association. See, the world is pernicious, vicious, and so divided. Why abide in something that cater to your defiance? Discipleship is deeming the Messiah as the refiner, yet you still clinging to that worldly knowledge as your reliance. Consider who's watching your fickle ways, cause more souls can be lost if you got shaky faith. Flee from being lukewarm like room temperature beverages. Here's some questions for the one shortchanging the king. You rather stay in the light or lay in the shade? You rather imitate Christ or remain the same? It matters if you live in life while claiming his name, and you forget that serving Christ means you gotta change fully.
Let go of the world
and hold on to his word.
Let go of the world
and hold on to his word.
Let go of the world
and hold on to his word.
Let go of the world.
Is it because I cry till I fall that you don't believe me when I say I'm hurt?
Hey, thought you could leave without saying goodbye.
I used to say I live my life a quarter mile at a time.
Guys, it's not an actual contract that you sign to sell your soul to the devil. It's not like you write your name on a dotted line of a contract that says your soul is mine if you sign this. However, in Matthew 16:26, it says, what profit is it to a man if he gains the whole world but loses his own soul? In other words, what are you gaining if you have to sin to win? A lot of celebrities sin to win, and the enemy continues giving them gifts, so they continue sinning to win. And now we're at a time where evil is just completely manifesting out of these artists. Let's check out a few that you listen to.
I told y'all earlier, you motherfuckers enter the rapture. And if ain't nobody flying up to heaven right now, obviously all y'all motherfuckers going to hell. Right with me.
That was Lil Uzi Vert, and here he goes again with his upside down cross. Guys, these artists don't fear God because their minds can't grasp the depth of God. Their mental capacity does not understand eternity. And here's another one, Playboi Carti with an upside down cross. I mean, Playboi Carti got a whole clothing line. Look how wicked this nonsense is. And people really still out here listening to these people. They think, oh, it's just music. No. When you listen to people like that, you come into agreement with them people. Here's another big name for y'all, Billie Eilish. Look how demonic this picture looks, first of all. Her eyes are completely black. She has black wings that are on fire. And this is one of the titles to her songs. All the good girls go to hell, yet you still listen to her. Guys, I'm gonna put it like this. If you truly love God, you should not be listening to these people, because these people are nothing but puppets for demonic sources. So when you come into agreement with those people, you come into agreement with demons. You come into agreement with evil. Trust me, a lot of them people don't even understand what they're in. If they could understand even a glimpse of eternity, they would be begging on their knees right now to God.
Couldn't believe what he said to me. He took his contract signature, please. You can have it all, but you know your soul, I'm a key.
That was Chris Brown saying he had a meeting with the devil. The devil told him he can have it all, but he had to lose his soul. Sound familiar? Matthew 16:26. For what is a man profited if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? What does it profit you? Life is short. Eternity is forever. Like I said, their brains don't understand eternity. And a lot of them are so far down in a deep dark hole that they don't even see light. They're far gone. And just like children of God go from glory to glory, getting more and more sealed with the Spirit of God, these people are getting more and more blemished in sin, getting more and more sealed in flesh. Listen, we have a soul, and we can choose to go with our flesh, but our flesh will lead us to damnation. And a lot of them know that. Look at this.
People don't glory God no more. People glory rappers and fame. This music game is the devil.
I won't be doing this music stuff anymore. I sold my soul to the motherfucking devil and I done prayed. I don't know if God can get me out of it.
Guys, this is what the music industry has become. A demonic playground. Seek Christ.